Thank you, Father. And so ancient of days, our Father, our God, the one from whom special blessings flow, this is our praise to you for your divine faithfulness in our journey as a church. This our praise to you, O Lord, because we know that as we continue even on this journey, you will never leave us nor forsake us. Lord, I ask for a special anniversary present for everyone hearing the sound of my voice today. Let it be said that because I came to celebrate with you, you granted that special desire of the heart. At the appointed time, when they open their mouth to ask, God of heaven and earth, answer in Jesus' name.
Amen.
We ask God that you will speak to us, give us a message that will encourage our hearts.
Amen.
Spirit of the living God, our guide, our comforter, our teacher, the one that has been ordering us all these years, we are asking now for the authority and the power for this hour. Let the name of our God be glorified.
Amen.
In the name of God the Father.
Amen.
God the Son.
Amen.
And God the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you, precious Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
Now let somebody shout hallelujah. Sitting next to you, you are blessed and highly favored. Please turn your Bibles with me very quickly to the book of Matthew, chapter 11. I'm going to be reading from verse 3. Matthew 11, from verse 3 through 5. If you are there, say amen. And he said unto him, art thou he that should come, or do we look for another? And Jesus answered and said unto them, go and show John again those things which ye do hear and see. Verse 5. The blind receive their sight. The lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear. The dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. May the Lord bless the reading and the hearing of his word in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I thank the Almighty God for the privilege this morning and the opportunity to bring this anniversary message. Amen. The theme for this anniversary is God revealed. God revealed. A theme that is both a prayer for God's divine intervention in the lives of his people and a desire for God to give us a deeper revelation of himself. I'll say that again. It is a theme that is both a prayer for God's divine intervention in the lives of his people, and also a desire for God to give us a deeper revelation of himself. The Bible passage that I just read to you, in Matthew chapter 11, verse 3, John the Baptist sent his disciples to Jesus on a fact-finding mission. The purpose of their mission was to ask Jesus to reveal himself to them. He said, art thou he that should come, or do we look for another? Are you the one that we are expecting, or do we look for somebody else? In other words, he has not been made clear to them yet. He has not been revealed to them. Whatever you're saying is that reveal yourself to us. But Jesus would have just said, I am he. But rather he responded in verses 4 and 5 of Matthew 11. He said, go and say to John, those things which you do hear and see. He said, the blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised up, the poor have the gospel preached to them. What Jesus was saying to those that John said to him was that by my fruits thou shalt know me. In other words, the testimonies of the people that had a divine encounter with me should reveal me. John, tell John that I'm real. Tell John that I'm real. My act or works should testify of my authenticity. Because this thing was given to glorify the name of the Lord in your life, I'm decreeing today that you will have a personal testimony to share about the Lord Jesus Christ. You have a personal testimony to share about what God has done in your life. Whatever is currently contending with God's glory in your life, today will be the end of that matter. You are hearing somebody say amen. I'm commanding every gate that is currently shut against you to open up in their own accord. Yes, every gate that is currently a hindrance to your personal progress today, in the name of Jesus, we are commanding them to be open. Because spiritually, gates are places of meeting where decisions are taken. You'll be surprised at so many gates. There are evil gates out there where decisions are taken against God's people. But I stand upon the word of the Lord that their decisions will not prosper.
Amen.
Their counsel will not stand.
Amen.
Only the will of God will be done in the life of somebody hearing the sound of my voice this morning. If you are that person, shout and hallelujah. Today the Jehovah Sabaoth, the Lord of hosts, will reveal himself to every enemy that is saying you will not go forward. That is saying your poor family will not go forward. That is saying the church of God will not move forward. Because the church of God will march on and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. This is the word of the Lord to somebody this morning. You are moving forward in Jesus' name. You can happily say a better hallelujah. Brethren, thank God for the signs, thank God for the wonders. Because those are just his next number. You don't come to the presence of the Lord and not expect signs and wonders. You don't go to the presence of the Lord and not expect something tangible to happen to you. I've always said to those that have heard me over and over again, when you are coming to God's presence, come expecting a miracle. We are moving forward now. Because the word of God will never ever return back to him word. He said, in his presence there is fullness of joy, and at his right hand there are pleasures forevermore. In other words, whatever have not made your joy to be full, I shall come into his house. Know that that change is coming. Why? Because the God that honors this world is going before you to his household. Thank God for the breakthroughs. But hear me, people of God, the desire of God for you and I is not just to look for signs and wonders, but to have a personal revelation of him. I was reading in one of the Bible passages. He said, God showed Moses his ways, but the children of Israel his acts. I said, Lord, I'd rather know your ways than be looking for your acts. There are people that are jumping from church to church looking for miracles. At the end of the day, they are still empty. Because it's just like you eating in the morning. And it's okay in the evening and tomorrow morning, no food. You'll be hungry again. But when you know the ways of the Lord, you are daily fed on that only because his ways will feed you. That's what you need. The miracles, when you know his ways, the miracles will come naturally. Do I always say amen to that?
Amen.
And that is why Jesus, before starting his church, in Matthew 16, Verse 13 to 19, the Bible passage I will read in the Bible reading of this morning. Called his disciples together. And he said, "Who do men say that I am?" And they started talking. Some say you are Elijah. Some say you are John the Baptist. Some say you are one of the prophets. And he said to them, "Who do you think I am? What am I personally to you? What I am? What do you know about me? Who am I to you?" And Peter answered, "That thou art Christ, the Son of the living God." It was upon this revelation that Jesus Christ built his church. When you have a personal understanding of who God is, everything changes. Daniel 11, 32 says that for the people that do know their God, they shall be strong and do what? Do as well. When you know God for yourself, divine confidence is installed in your heart. The spirit of fear will be far from you. You automatically become, stop pleasing people. You love people. But your desire will be to please God. You stop becoming a man pleaser because you know God for yourself. Divine peace will come into your heart because you are no longer people driven, but you are now God driven. And because of your level of peace, you will begin to enjoy divine health. Because you are no longer worried over situations or circumstances that you have no control over. Do you know how many people have worried themselves to death even before the miracle comes? We are going somewhere, just stay with me. Finally, when you know him personally, surrendering to Jesus will become easy. I was sharing with some of our churches in Newark at the joint Holy Communion service just a couple of days ago on building a healthy church. And I said in that meeting that if every one of us believers will make it our life pursuit to know God, the result will be a healthy church. Because a healthy church is where there is a passion for the word of God. Praise the Lord. And based on this daily intake of God's word, the spirit man, the spirit of men and women will be built up. Amen? And I was sharing, I said, do you know when you say an angry man? A hungry man is an angry man. How many of us have heard that saying before in the Bible? When somebody is really hungry, no food. The same way it is in the spiritual. A hungry man is an angry man. Just as we need physical food to live, so also in the spiritual we need spiritual food to live. That's why Jesus Christ said, "Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded from the mouth of God." It is the reason why many come to some churches and they walk away. It's not because your church is not beautiful. It's not because the people are not dancing and all that. It's because they are not spiritually fed. That is why I love the Redeemed Church of God. When I came to this church years ago, what made me to stay in the church? I wasn't thinking of being a pastor. I'm a last survivor. But God, thank God I'm a pastor today. But what made me to stay was, at every level, there is something about the church where you learn about God. You know, it's not as if you come to Sunday school, you have the word of God. You come to Bible study, the word of God is there. You come to work as a trainee, there are provisions, there are resources for people to be built up spiritually. The reason why you see many are still famished spiritually is because they don't attend any of those meetings. All you need to do is come to Sunday service in the morning. You discover that inside the scripture, where the service starts from, people are not there. It is allowed the devil. Because the devil knows that when you are spiritually fed, he's finished. Because a healthy church is the one that has a passion for the word of God. Every other thing flows from there. All I have to do is go to a church and sit at the back and observe their worship. When I see somebody worshiping, another person just looking, wondering what is going on, you can tell that person is not spiritually fed. When you know the word of God, when you have faith spiritually, do you know you will worship the one that is feeding you? If you know, for instance, you have one feeding me every morning, night and day. Trust me, I will see you as anybody's. It is the way everything flows from there. Our discipleship, which is mission, which is the core of Christianity, winning souls, flows from what I'm talking about. A healthy church will have all these qualities. A healthy church will have is a place where you have love and caring. This thing is done passionately. Why? Because the word of God has taken root. In the name that is above every name. As we are moving forward as a church, the word of God will begin to burn in our hearts.
Amen.
Our desire for the word of God will increase.
Amen.
We believe that, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord, somebody. Because I told them that the spiritual health of any church has a direct effect on the physical well-being of that church. It's not my words. It's words of Jesus. Matthew 6:33. He said, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. But that is just by the way. Praise the Lord. God is daily revealing himself to us. If you can catch the revelation, it will become your personal inheritance. Deuteronomy 29:29 says, the secret things belong to God. Say, those things that are revealed to us belong to us and to our children forever. The word of God is a book of inheritance. You can study the word of God from now until tomorrow. Except God opens your eyes to see the hidden treasure in the scripture that you are reading, it is not yours yet. But the day God makes it your own, opens your eyes to see it, it becomes your inheritance. And you will run with it in Jesus' name. So God revealed, he said, Lord, reveal yourself to me in your word. From today, as you open the word of the living God, to study about him, the Spirit of the Lord will open your eyes to see the hidden treasure even in that verse that you are reading.
Amen.
And you will run with it your life without remaining the same again.
Amen.
Yeah, yes, I want to say amen to that.
Amen.
I was reading a story. The story of Lazarus, most of us know it, but some of us don't. John 11:1-45. Lazarus was a man that Jesus Christ loved. The Bible said that Lazarus fell sick and died. And Lazarus had two sisters, Martha and Mary, that Jesus Christ also loved. Some of us already know about Mary. The root of the scripture, Mary was the woman that anointed the feet of Jesus and used her hair to wash his feet, to wipe his feet. So Jesus had a special love for this family. Now, their brother was sick. They sent a message to Jesus, because he was far away. Say, your friend, I'm just paraphrasing now, Lazarus is sick. And Jesus Christ said, I've heard. And he delayed going to them. While he was delayed, something terrible happened. Lazarus died. And Jesus Christ knew it in the spirit where he was, that Lazarus was dead. Because he told his disciples, say, Lazarus is dead. But let's go to him. Somebody in their right mind will say, if he is dead, why are you going there again? We say, let's go. And he got there. When I was listening to this story, God opened my eyes to see after the theme of this scripture, of this anniversary. That the reason why Jesus Christ delayed in going to Martha and Mary to heal their brother Lazarus of his sickness, it is because that our God, to reveal to them that he, our God, lives outside the cycle of time. God is not limited by time. He's not constrained by time. Please pay attention now. If you're not paying attention to the world, begin to pay attention now. Amen. God is not limited by what? By time. As human beings, we have become prisoners of time. And that's the truth. Many, if not most of the pressures or problems or obstacles that we encounter in life involves time limits of some kind. Time has become the enemy of many instead of being our friend. For instance, if you become apprehensive, because you know that the money that you have in the bank account We run out before your next day. Time will automatically become your enemy. That's the truth. But God wants to encourage somebody here today. If you have been believing God for one breakthrough or the other, and you have become desperate, time has become your enemy. When time becomes your enemy, there is only one result: depression, anxiety, bitterness. Praise the Lord. And this could lead to other serious concerns like hypertension, blood sugar problem. Why? Because we are time-driven people. Do I hear somebody say amen to that?
Yes.
But today, time will become your friend.
Amen.
Because it was the situation that Martha and Mary found themselves. They were waiting for Jesus to show up to heal their brother Lazarus. But Jesus delayed, knowing that Lazarus was dead. Brethren, he delayed because he wanted to reveal to Martha and Mary that he lives outside the circle of time. And the result was that he came and Lazarus rose from the dead. What that is telling you and I today, I don't know what we have been waiting for. The God that we serve, the Bible says, is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He can go into your past. Take whatever is in your past and bring it to your future. He is not constrained by time. He can take what is in your future and bring it to your present. If that is what will make you fulfilled. I've seen in the scripture that God stopping the forces of heaven so that his people's will, his will will be done in the life of his people. God can do it again. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
I don't know how long you have been waiting on the Lord. Because there is a message for you today. The God that you have been waiting on is not constrained by time.
Right.
Do not allow your waiting period to become the time when you are going to become sick. When this God was waiting, there was a sister who had been married for so many years. When you see this sister, all of a sudden you see her, she acts like someone who is mad now. Every time somebody talks to her, she reacts violently. You cannot even say something without thinking that it is because of her. Do you know what is going on there? My time is running out. My time is running out. I'm going to get to menopause soon. But I am standing upon the word of the Lord. If only he knows that the God of heaven and earth knows everything about herself. That at his own appointed time, he will make everything beautiful in her life.
Amen.
Everyone hearing this out of my voice, I don't know who God is speaking to this morning. The Almighty God has no time constraint. He will fast forward. He will do whatever needs to be done in your life. So for his will to be done in your life, he will do whatever needs to be done to your time. His purpose will be revealed in your life. No devil will share his glory in your life. Only his name will be glorified. Time should not be your enemy. That is why when Martha came to Jesus, he said, "My brother Lazarus is dead." And Jesus Christ said, "I am the resurrection. I am the resurrection. I'm not constrained by anything. Because Lazarus was living, he saw Lazarus in his own realm. He wasn't seeing Lazarus in the human realm. He saw Lazarus in the realm of Jesus. Lazarus was still alive. In the realm of Jesus, his plan and purpose for you is still real.
Amen.
Your children are coming back.
Amen.
Your children are moving forward.
Amen.
It doesn't matter what you are seeing right now, they are moving forward.
Amen.
It doesn't matter how they are manifesting, you are moving forward.
Amen.
Because in the realm of Jesus, they are wonderfully and carefully made.
Amen.
In the realm of Jesus, they have been for signs and for wonders.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
That is why I believe with all my heart that even where God is taking us as a church, we have not seen it yet. There will be a manifestation in Jesus' name.
Amen.
God can never be late. He doesn't wear a wristwatch. He doesn't wear a wristwatch. He will reach into your past to pull your promises back into your presence.
Amen.
He will resurrect something that you thought you have lost forever.
Amen.
Just like he did in the case of Lazarus. If God has raised Lazarus from the dead, we visit you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
The anniversary message, because of my time, I was giving just a few minutes. The anniversary message from God to somebody hearing me right now is that you must break free from the stressing restraints of time and put your full trust in the eternal God who lives outside the circle of time.
Hallelujah.
After you have done everything humanly possible, trust God. I'm not saying you shouldn't do what you have to do. The Bible says after you have done what you need to do, stand therefore. You have done everything. You made yourself beautiful. You rejoice, you are smiling. And you're wondering, where is my wife? Where is my husband? They are coming. Keep looking beautiful. Keep looking handsome. Because very soon, you will rejoice.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
All you need to do is to trust God. And while you are waiting on Him, worship Him. Make worshiping of Jehovah, the one that is in control of time, your daily affair. Worship Him. Don't go carrying long faces. So long as you have settled in case of your relationship with Him, you are born again. You are His child. He is just a master of time. When we are waiting, it is an opportunity for God to prove Himself to you, you alone, that He is your mighty God.